introduction, and this year's Nobel Prize in Chemistry rewards the development of lithium-ion batteries. These lightweight, rechargeable, and portable batteries are now used in everything from mobile phones to laptop and electric vehicles. It can also store a significant amount of energy from solar and wind, making possible a fossil fuel-free society. And these three Nobel laureates contributed a lot in the development of these batteries. John Goodenough, Samuel Whittingham, and Akira Yoshino. But on the day of Chemistry Nobel Prize announcement, I was sitting at my office and I received this message from my friend Mark, saying that my prediction about John Goodenough was right, and this year's Chemistry Nobel Prize goes to lithium-ion batteries. And I jumped out of my chair screaming, "Finally!" Actually, my PhD is all about the method development for lithium chemical chips in batteries. And during my work, I also encountered several times Professor John Goodenough's work, and I also spent 6 months in Claire's lab in Cambridge, where we worked together and published an article. And Claire is a student and co-worker of Professor John Goodenough. But let's look around. If you think electricity is now the driving force of our new modern world, and it is shaping the future, starting from this projector to the mind, to presenter, laptop, mobile, everything runs on electricity. And to a certain extent, it actually affects our daily life. But the question is, what is it? So, apart from running all the appliances, we also experience it in daily life. So when we rub the balloon on our hairs, the electrons from the balloon goes to the hair, making the balloon as negatively charged and the hairs as positively charged. Opposite charge attracts each other, and that's why the hair goes attracts towards the balloon. But basically, if you think that from knowingly or unknowingly, we were playing with electrons, and a continuous flow of electrons is electricity. So in this regard, battery space transform how we use and access electricity. So batteries are portable and very small. We can use it anywhere, and it works without wires and cables, which also gave birth to many devices, starting from mobiles to laptop, and it's keep growing. So the question is, what is battery now? So batteries have chemical energy which transformed into electrical energy. Do you remember this lemon battery from the science labs? Super cool. In this battery there is lemon, obviously, and then lemon has lemon juice, which is a citric acid. Now this citric acid reacts with the name, which is zinc, and produces a lot of electrons. Now this produces an electrical difference between the name and the 5 cent copper coin. Now when we connect this name with a conducting wire to the copper coin, electrons start flowing from the name to the copper coin. And that is the electricity. If we place a bulb there, then we start glowing. Now, in more technical term, this the lemon juice, the citric acid, is the electrolyte. The zinc name, which interacts with the electrolyte and produces a lot of electrons, is the anode. And where the electron travels is the cathode. So this is basically same in a very regular battery, where you have these three components, and the process is exactly the same. There is a positive terminal, which is called the cathode. There is a negative terminal, which is the anode. And the solution in between is the electrolyte. Now, there is a chemical reaction goes inside the battery, which produces a lot of electrons in the anode. And that generates a potential difference. Also, the electrolytes make sure that the electron cannot travel directly from the anode to the cathode. And that's why, when we connect through a conducting wire, the electrons start flowing through. the wire. And when we put any appliances in that, it powers the appliance or the gadget. Now, in case of lithium-ion rechargeable batteries, there is also lithium at the anode. So when it is discharging, the electrons from the anode goes to the cathode, to the wire, and at the same time, the lithium ions from the anode goes to the cathode. Now, the process gets completely reversed when we start charging it. Now, the electrons are traveling from the cathode to the anode, to the wire, and lithium ions are moving from cathode to anode through the electrolyte within the battery. Now we know how the battery works. The question comes, what makes a good battery? And in this sense, lithium-ion batteries are very special. Different materials have different chemistry, and this builds a different kind of batteries, which has different shape and size. And to understand what makes this battery to very good, or some batteries, there are like 100 different kinds of batteries, and 70% of the batteries are rechargeable batteries. So, what makes a battery super successful? For that, we need to answer a couple of more questions first. So, starting from that, how much energy can store? Is how many times you can recharge them? How powerful they are? Can we produce them at industrial scale? Is it going to be too expensive? Or is it safe to use? Or is it going to explode? And in this, the first is like, so to understand that, all these three scientists spent a lot of time in the lab and developed the right material which created the right battery we are using as lithium-ion batteries today. So start from the how much energy can store. So there, for example, if you think about this electric car, there is limited space. And if you want to travel from, let's say, from Munich to Berlin, we need a lot of energy. And the more energy we can store in this limited space, the longer we can drive. So that is the energy density of the battery in the small space. Now once we reach to Berlin, now the battery is completely drained out and we need to recharge it. So when we recharge it, that's the one cycle of the battery. And how many times we can go to Berlin and come back using the same battery pack says that what is the life cycle of that battery. And these two properties are the most important which creates the lithium-ion batteries or any rechargeable batteries. And in this sense, Samuel Lithium worked a lot. So in his early stage of career, he was trying to understand how the lithium ions or any ion moves inside the solid. And his idea was that how we can pack more ions in small cell. So he was trying to solve this shape puzzle. There is a piece of the puzzle is a solid where you have a material and the other pieces are the ions which you need to store. So if you find the right solution, you can store a lot of ions in a very small solid. Now that's one thing. The second thing is that in this shape puzzle, when we solve it, we can also disassemble it. That means the lithium can go in and out of the material without causing too much energy. Now, he asks his co-workers to like find out what is the best material possible, and soon they realize that there is the cathode material which is made up of titanium and sulfur can accumulate a lot of lithium ions. So he proposed his first rechargeable lithium-ion battery model where the cathode was made up of titanium and sulfur and the anode was made up of lithium metal and that has a voltage of 2 volt. Now this is the first recipe, but soon it was not very powerful. So that's the second question. Like, what does that mean? Is that how much energy we can extract from the battery continuously? So if we move from a car to a drone, where the space is already very small, we need to store a lot of energy. And at the same time, we need to extract a lot of energy continuously. Then only the drone is going to fly. And that's the power of the battery, or the power density of the battery. So John Goodenough initially started his career at the age in MIT, where he developed the random access memory, RAM, which is still the one of the basic component of computing. But later he moved to offshore and then start working on batteries. And he has a very good understanding of the interior of any material. So by looking at the sample's battery, he realized that if he replaces the sulfur with oxygen and use any other metal, then it will help to increase the power density of the battery. So he asked his lab members to start looking for a systematic search where there is a lithium metal oxide which can accumulate also a lot of lithiums. And it doesn't took too long, or let's say 5 years, to find out the right composition. Let's start with, so instead of titanium and sulfur, he used cobalt and oxygen. And then the same cathode anode as a lithium metal, and then goes on. So this produces 4 volts of voltage, which was the double of the standard factory. Now, he has the right recipe to have a battery which is very high energy density, high power density, has a very good life cycle of more than 1,000 times, but there was still a problem. It was not safe. When they start using it, start catching fire. And the reason was that, and we are aware of that, still a battery, many battery gets fired or explodes. It's always in the news. What happens is that when we charge and discharge, the lithium ions moves from anode to cathode and goes back to from cathode to anode. It slowly starts making a wire-like structure from anode to cathode. And once these wires are long enough that it can connect the anode to cathode, there is a short circuit which ignites fire and which could lead to an explosion. And that's how this battery starts catching fire. And that put them a little bit set back, and it was not working that well. But at the same time, on the other side of the globe, Professor Akira Yoshino was playing with organic battery materials, so carbon-based battery materials. And he also developed the first lithium-ion polymer batteries, which is extremely light. And you can see that his false batteries are exactly that. So he had the idea that if he replaced that lithium metal with some carbon-based material where he can store the lithium, that most probably is going to change the situation. So soon, his lab members realized that there is a petroleum product called petroleum coke, which is a byproduct of the oil refining process. It has a sponge-like structure. It's made up of carbon. And a lot of lithium can go inside, soaks a lot, and very easily one can take it out. So that's what he did, is I replaced an anode with petroleum coke. Now, they did a lot of chemical setups or experiments to show that there is no formation of wires or short circuits. And later, he also assigned a group of people to do physical tests. So, trying to hit the battery, break it, and drop it, and whatever possible, and it could actually damage the battery, but it was not, there was no sign of fire or any kind of explosion. And that was the time when the first lithium-ion battery came into the picture, which was safe to use in public or in daily life. Then some companies took that recipe, and in 1991, there was the first industrial production of lithium-ion batteries. But this development didn't stop there. In the last 10 years, there is more than 200,000 research articles get published about batteries, in which more than 50% are about lithium-ion batteries. And this shows that there is still a lot of space to improve. Starting from to understand the base of electronic structure, so going basic for the structure, and how if we understand more, then we can store maybe more energy there. The second one is like developing new materials which can power even a bigger equipment or appliances. And the third one, which is now actually in very fashion, is that how to recharge and discharge battery very fast. So 5 minutes and you are battery like fully recharged. Now this also shows that the fundamental research has a huge impact on our society and this development and the amount of time and energy we put in there. At some point the time comes back to give the society back. And from the inception of the idea of the battery, we have walked a long way. And these developments are not limited to the electronic gadgets. And in parallel, it also enhanced the development in other fields. So communication, high-speed communication, GPS, smart cities, renewable energy, the satellites up in the sky, and how we can access and use more renewable energy. And in the future, there will be more to come. And with the hope of a better tomorrow, I thank you all for joining me tonight.
Thank you very much. Really exciting talk and exciting topic. So we have time for questions. So there's a question here.
Okay, so this question is about like what are the workable materials, are the good materials, and is there the logic behind the development? Yeah. So it is way more complicated. When in this, what I showed is just three components of the batteries, which is the cathode, anode, and the electrolyte. But the real battery, or the one we talk in general in the research, has many other layers. And that depends on where is like the interface, how a material of the anode reacts with the electrolyte. And then the interface of the cathode which reacts with the anode. And all of this, there is a lot of chemistry goes inside it. Also, so this determines like how good the material is going to work. And this is not a very easy question to answer. So this is like a lot of chemistry. And one can test it, but this doesn't give you like a very clear answer from a very beginning, like it's the way to work.
This is just kind of your work, right? Would you say a few words about what you're doing in this direction?
Yeah, so what I am trying to understand is like how the lithium moves inside the batteries. So when you discharge the battery, the lithium goes to the cathode. Now we use a technique called NMR, so nuclear magnetic resonance. It's the same technique which you use in MRI. So you get like very precise location where the lithiums are. Now this is a very atomistic level where one can determine that how what is the local environment. So if my lithium is going to an octahedral site, and that's also more detailed in science, or a tetrahedral site, or is it somewhere hanging in between? And all of this can be recorded very well in NMR. So you can see the signals clearly. And what I'm doing is I'm trying to develop a quantum chemical method which can do this kind of calculations and then combine them with a machine learning model which is going to extend those theories for a larger systems. So this is a long way to go.
So this is a very scientific explanation. What I found cool about what our speaker is doing, they're doing the mathematical and computational simulation of the atomic level processes in order to understand better what's going on there and how to produce better.
So, can I
see the one that's like that? I'm not sure. We can go on to the next question, sorry, we just like a little bit derailed. Like, so.
Thank you very much for your cool talk. I wanted to ask, as I'm not a chemist, you said back to what Gulenov did. He basically replaced the cathode, he replaced titanium to a metal oxide, right?
Yeah.
And it took him 5 years to do that.
Yeah.
And my question is, why does it take so long? You have like 40, 50 metals at most, right?
So his question is that why it took so long? And so what he did is like, so what Professor John Gulenov did is like there was a recipe to create a lithium-ion batteries, and to increase the potential or voltage of that battery, he thought that there could be a replacement of the sulfur with the oxygen atom, which should bind to some other metals. And it took 5 years. That's not a problem. When in this speed, from that point where we already know what a cathode material should look like, there is only 3 very good materials came out in this picture. And that is just not like depends on what should be the structure, but at the same time, if you put the lithium, it should be easily removable. So once you go in and out, it should be easy. It should not break down. So the life cycle, 1100 times, is very important. So there are materials, if you take the lithium out, what will happen is that the material will break down. And then you cannot recharge it again. So there were like a lot of things, and it's also the lithium cobalt oxide is not an easy material to handle. It's also toxic, and there's plenty of other things which also comes in, but determines that what is a good battery.
That's a great answer. So we have time for one last question, I think. I think there is a question there.
Is if it's for the point of view of maintenance of the battery, is it better to always go all the way down and then up, or this is the question?
Yeah, basically, yes. Yeah, but then what I would say is a very general comment, but it always depends on what materials you have in the batteries. Yeah? So the normal AA size rechargeable batteries made up of lithium, nickel, hydrides, which is a very different material than a phone battery, which is made up of lithium iron phosphates, and these two works completely different, right? So in some cases the life cycle means that how many times you fully recharge and discharge, but if you do it just 70% and you recharge it again, then it will be just that one it's the 30% of one cycle. So if you keep your batteries always full charge, it's not a problem, but this always depends on what materials are used in your battery. So
okay, I think we can have one last question. There is this person who wants to ask the question, please. There is some research in direction of making batteries more environmental friendly, and this is the correct right? Yeah.
Yes, but so that's what I mentioned. Like in the field of research, there is like more than 200,000 papers published every year in last 10 years, and I can't read all of them. But
but the question is like, what's the current status?
Yes, everyone trying their best to find the better solution. Starting from reducing the toxicity to make the batteries more stable, making it faster charging, discharging, not breaking it, increasing the life cycle, everything. And that's why this field is slowly growing. But you know, when we are like now working at the atomic level, which is very difficult. So to improve that, it requires time and more understanding.
Okay, this is a very nice answer, I think. Okay, so are we having pizza or not? Someone have a look?
No.
This is all. We're having some technical problems with pizza, so I don't know, maybe I'm trying to screw us over. So we're going for the break. Unfortunately, you can get some soft drinks, beer, and it's at the left there. And yeah, and. With some hope we will have pizza soon. So thank you very much.